C-section.
Oh, pure business, amma. Pure business. Pure business. 100% business. Left alone, naturally, 99% of the women will deliver through the natural route, which is the ideal route, good for the child, because we live in this world not because of us, but because of the germs that are in us. In our gene, you have only 23,000 human genes and 2.5 trillion germ genes. And between the mouth and the anus, you have 10 to the power 13 germs, which is 100,000 billion germs. And they all come to you while you come out in the genital tract of the mother. You're not listening to me, young lady. You're not caught that last sentence. What did I say last? This is what happens in the class. A lot of students, you know, talk. Then I ask them, what was the last sentence I said? They don't know. The last sentence I said, young lady, is that most of these germs that you have inside you, which protect you, which are your saviors, and they come to you from your mothers and during the delivery. And if you take a child out from here, that child will not have a good immune system all its life. 1% of women sometimes have obstructed labor where the pelvis is smaller than the head of the child, then cesarean section is needed. But today we do, New York Hospital, they found 90% of cesarean sections. Some very sophisticated English talking, you know, kitty party girls, they want a cesarean section because they don't want to go through labor. That is their concern. Now there is a big movement called normal birthing movement, started in America and Canada. If you want, I'll give you a reference to the lady who is in charge, and they are doing wonderful work. From the time you become pregnant, they teach you and your husband how to deliver. Husband delivers you in your own house in the presence of your mother, father, everybody. And no restrictions, no nothing, no sterilization, no episiotomy, no shaving, nothing. You're a normal woman. One fine morning you deliver and next day you're all right. Next.
There's a lady here waiting for very long.
Sir, I have a doubt regarding the thing that there is no need for regular checkup unless your body tells something. Your body
yes.
tells you.
I said that.
There is something wrong or not.
I said
but,
that.
No, sir. By regular screening, are we not catching earlier cervical cancer?
Fascinating. Fascinating idea. This is what you are being fed by the industry. I will give you a reference if you are a doctor or a scientist.
There's I'm a doctor. Nice, I'm a doctor.
Sir. Oh, good, good. That's why this
I'm
question.
I'm an allopathy doctor.
Good. Allopathy doctor
so
and a gynecologist.
I have my doubt. I have heard so many of your CDs. And this doubt is coming
very good. I'm,
on
I'm
and off.
I'm
so
answering
this is an
you.
Opportunity for me to ask you in person and clarify my doubt, sir.
But you don't have the patience to listen to me. Sit down. I'll tell you.
I have one more question, sir. Regarding this eradication programs. We have got a lot of eradication programs like polio, national tuberculosis program, all these things. If your child gets temperature,
good question. So I'll answer
we
that.
Are not, we should be worried. But if we leave, now one child norm is there for so many parents. If we leave the child as such, without intervening, if he develops encephalitis, what the poor parent can do? This is my question, sir.
All your questions are over now?
Okay, sir.
Please sit down, ma. Now, do you think polio is eradicated by vaccination? And that's what the statistics tell you. 27,000 children are now suffering from what is called non-polio acute paralytic illness. Those who have got polio vaccination, the poor children, do you know why? This polio vaccination, oral vaccination, even according to our textbooks, is prevented from being given to poor children because without protein in the body, this doesn't produce antibodies. On the contrary, the live virus that you're given in the mouth goes through the gut and converts into P2, P3, the real dangerous polio virus, and produces a paralytic illness. And we still have the illness, but we have not named it different, that's all. For political reasons, the name is changed. So the name now is not polio, it's called acute paralytic non-polio paralysis. Please read about that, ma, number one. Number two, tuberculosis you think is gone because of tuberculosis searching program? You know, in 1956, Government of India invited one of the greatest tuberculosis specialists in the world called J.R. Bignall. John Bignall was the professor of respiratory disease in London. In 56, he came. Nehru gave him a helicopter. He went around the whole country and said, look, Mr. Prime Minister, you have about 5 lakhs TB patients in India. Please don't get the drugs now not supplied very well. Don't give them drugs. Give them good food and good ventilation and good treatment. Half of them will get cured. And they, with them, the germ will die. The other half will die. With them, the germ will die. So at the end of 5 years, India will be rid of tuberculosis. Do you know what Nehru said? This white man wants Indians to die. So Nehru allowed the drugs to come. He believed like you, that drug comes, it goes. Drug came, drug came, drug came. Today, all over the world, we have such a huge load of tuberculosis, which is called white death. In America, every doctor, every nurse is being given anti-tubercular treatment before going to the hospital because you can be tuberculosis. There's a resurgence of tuberculosis all over because you can't kill the germ with a drug, man. It's not a proposition at all. Tuberculosis germ was not even a germ which was killing man. It is soil germ. Because we became very sophisticated, we started plowing the digging the thing, the germ got airborne. Now we got human tuberculosis, bovine tuberculosis, avian tuberculosis. Tuberculosis has not gone, it has come back with a bang. Now all these dot geet, this, that, survey, give, it's all behind that, there is a big business. If you want to know how big this business is, you must know a little more about drug companies. Write down. The truth about drug companies is a book written by the former editor of the New England Journal of Medicine, a woman like you, a committed professor like you, in Johns Hopkins Hospital. Her name is Marcia Angell. And Marcia writes this beautiful book called Truth About Drug Companies. Side heading is how they cheat the world and what to do about it. Marcia Angell, Harper Collins, $17. Please read the book. Okay? Now that's about it. Now coming to your screening business. Big article. The screening industry. Write down. Author's name is Richard Smith, the editor of the British Medical Journal. In the British Medical Journal. So go to internet and say Richard Smith, the screening industry, and you will read everything. But there are two exceptions. If you are a heavy smoker, if you are a heavy alcoholic, your body's message to you will be lost. So you must have a regular checkup if you don't stop your smoking and if you don't stop drinking. Now you asked a very pertinent question. Cancer screening. Okay? You said, oh, I have seen cervical cancer patients, advanced stage. I could catch them young. When is that young? That cervical cancer started as a mutated cell 25 years ago. You have to catch it, remove her uterus and the ovaries also. At this rate, by another 10 years, Angelina Jolie will be left with only probably head or leg. So, madam, this is all industry business, ma. You see, because I wish you asked another question. Can't we treat it young? Studies have shown that in the asymptomatic stage, if any give treatment that's of no use, it only kills the patient faster. It applies to hypertension, diabetes, etc., etc. These are all lifestyle diseases. Do you know why you get hypertension and diabetes? Because of stress. What is the stress? See, we were hunter-gatherers in the forest thousands of years ago. And that time, tiger used to come to kill you. So you had to run away from the tiger. God gave you an autonomic nervous system. As a doctor, you understand that. So when you see the tiger, you want to run. And to run, you require sugar. You require blood pressure to go up. You require heart rate to go up. And God gave you the adrenaline. Today, the same system is there in you, the autonomic nervous system, it's not changed. You are not seeing a tiger, but you're seeing human tigers now. Your husband may be a tiger, your wife may be a tiger, your boss may be a tiger, your colleague may be a tiger, your student may be a tiger. And when you see this tiger, your blood pressure goes up, your sugar goes up, your cholesterol goes up. But you can't run away from the tiger. The forest tiger, you run away, this all come down. Here you sit and suffer, and it goes up and remains up. Did you get that? Now we doctors tell our patients foolishly, I will give you this chemical, it will all come down. What will come down? Report will come down, not the body. So if you want a good report, take the drugs meticulously. But if you don't want a good report, you can take it easy. You know, I'll tell you this, of course, one sparrow doesn't make a summer. I've had many patients, but one patient is very nice. This man was a diabetic, very severe diabetic. But he was hard-working young man. He lived up to 89. And he used to come to me. He has to come from a place called Manjeshwara, which is about, it's about quite a distance from Mangalore. And to the railway station, he has to walk 10 miles in the morning. So he'll have a big ganji uta and then walk to the railway station. Then he'll catch the train, come to Mangalore. And in Mangalore, he had Arakanat business. So he'll walk to the Bandar, another for 10 miles. And then after all that, he will go and have a sumptuous lunch. If there is payasam, he'll have about 3-4 courses of that. And then he will take his blood sugar and come to me. When I examine him, he is absolutely fit. So I pat him on the back and say, "You are fine, Mr. Chowta, you are nothing to worry about." He says, "I have been following everything that you said correctly." So I said, "You're not eating anything?" "No, no, no, I'm not eating at all. No, 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 no. I don't eat." Then while going out, he will say, "I have brought my blood report." He'll take it out, put it on my table and run away because it's 600 milligrams. But he didn't die. So initially, for about 40 years, I used to tell his children, his children are all big people. One man is here. He was Kalakshetra chairman and all. I used to tell them, you must be very strict with your father and all. Then afterwards, I said, "Look, leave the old man alone. He wants to enjoy life. He was eating payasam. He was eating sugar. He was eating everything that he wanted. Lived up to 89. One fine morning, instead of getting up and going to the railway station, he went to meet his maker in heaven. Don't you think that's a good one?" Okay.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes, hello. Sir.
Can I have a question?
Doctor, one second. When consciousness is throughout the universe, in this existence, and mind plays a major role, why the modern science and the academia and the present science is totally missing, and somebody brings about to expose this consciousness and mind, and no real effort is taken in the side of academic and science? For that, I want your comment, and I want, you are doing the right thing, but we people have to take up this in a bigger way.
What a fascinating question. Max Planck, the father of quantum physics, wrote, I quote, "Consciousness is fundamental. All else is derived from consciousness." And he said, "Even matter is derived from consciousness." Consciousness is universal consciousness, that's called the universal mind, which we lay people call as God. And individual consciousness, that's your mind, and your mind is not. Where is the mind? Never mind.